system, you can also combine, because it becomes easy for us to talk. This is only arbitrary, high pressure, intermediate and low pressure system. So just for the sake of talking about these different components, so you know the low pressure system, you can start with the flow control knobs. So flow control knobs are there. Then you have the proportionating devices are there inside, just beyond the flow control knobs.
I'm getting a phone.
No, phone is not. Phone is. That's why it's just sound.
Put the belt and give you, sir. Yeah? The belt. Phone tell it good, sir.
Right, okay. So, as long as it doesn't make sound, it's fine. I have to make sound. No, so, okay, now. We know that the low pressure system, mainly the proportionating devices. Yesterday we were discussing about the Link 25 and the SRMC or the ORMC, the oxygen ratio monitor control. So after that is the flow control valves. They are called as the pin valves, so flow control valves. Then the flow meters, and within the flow meters we have bobbins also. The flow meter assembly is called as. So after that is the back bar, and then the vaporizers. And then you have, in case of Datex Omega, you have the check valve and the pop-off valve, and then the common gas outlet. So up to the common gas outlet, you have the components of low pressure system. So just briefly, we'll discuss about them. I ask you about the safety features, like we just discussed about yesterday, about the safety features as far as the high pressure system and then the intermediate pressure system. So let us just discuss about the safety features as far as the low pressure system. So, what are the safety features of the flow control? The first thing we always tell is whether they are color coded and touch coded. So, what do you mean by color coded? Oxide is always
white.
Nitrous oxide is blue. What about air? Air is also now
black and white.
Yeah, it's a common stripes of black and white will be there for air. So, that is one of the things. They are touch coded. So, I need not have to know what I am touching, whether I am touching nitrous oxide or I am touching oxygen. Oxygen is the largest one among all the three, and it is cylindrical, and the flutes are broad and they are widely placed. So that is what is the oxygen flow control knob. It is the largest, it is cylindrical, it is white in color, it has got flutes, and the distance between the flutes, flutes means corrugations. The flutes, distance between the flutes is wide. And whereas the, both the nitrous oxide and air, air is many times is black, and then nitrous oxide is blue, and these are conical, they are small and conical. So because they are small and conical, if I touch any one of them, I know that I am not touching oxygen. If I am touching the oxygen, it is the largest one and it is cylindrical, I can easily know, and also the flutes. So that is very important. The second thing is, when I want to reach, so when I want to reach, I should always reach for oxygen only. So that's why oxygen will be, even in the older machines, it used to be more close to the anesthesiologist who will be standing at the common gas outlet. So I'll be standing at the common gas. This is the common gas outlet. I'll be standing somewhere there. So you know that if I want to reach, the main idea, purpose of this is when I want to reach, I should be able to reach only the oxygen first. Whatever the flow control knob, if I want to reach, I should not be reaching for the nitrous or air. I should be reaching only for oxygen, because oxygen is so important. And all the, whatever the changes we have made is mainly to prevent any hypoxic mixture being delivered. That is one of the things. So you may be asked why oxygen will be on the downstream. So this is one thing. Oxygen is always downstream because of the flow control knob itself. So because you should be able to reach it. The second thing is, whenever there are, you have multiple tubings, multiple flow meters or four tubes. So suppose if any one of them get damaged, so suppose if you have nitrous oxide, you have the oxygen, sorry, the air is there in between, and the oxygen is the more towards the downstream. So even if there is a air, this thing starts leaking or there is a damage, so then the nitrous oxide will flow out, but oxygen will be directly going to the patient. So, if you have the opposite, for example, oxygen is on the upstream and the most downstream is being nitrous oxide. So, if the one of the the middle one breaks, so then oxygen will be going out and the patient will be getting more of nitrous oxide. Because one thing you should always realize, whatever the safety features are there in the anesthesia machine or the workstation, ends at the flow meter level. Ends at the flow meter level. And from the flow meter to the common gas outlet, you don't have any safety features. These check valve, pop-up valve, they are not safety features. They are only to prevent probably the effect of back pressure on the flow control valves, and also to have less effect on the pumping effect and then the pressurizing. That's all. They don't have much on the delivery of hypoxic mixture being delivered to the patient. So this is one thing you should realize. All the safety features end at flow meters, because whatever the safety features that are there in the flow meters, are that's all. And there can be a lot of leak from the flow meters to the common gas. So that's why before actually using the workstation or anesthesia machine, you have to check for leaks between the flow meter assembly and the common gas outlet. So that is what we will discuss at the end. So now, if you just now, I was talking to you about the flow control knobs. One of the safety features again in the flow control knobs is there is a stop at both ends. Now, if the stop has gone, then the flow control knob will come to your hand. That's what has occurred here. The stop is not there, probably. So somebody must have kept on rotating it. So then it must have come to their hands, they must have kept it here, and gradually it gets lost. That's why you can see here. So that's why in modern workstations, you have the stops for either for the minimal and the maximal, you have the stop. So you cannot go beyond the minimal or you cannot go beyond the maximum. So that is again a very good feature that is been added. Now otherwise, you know, I was telling so much about touch coding, color coding. Where is the touch coding here? Of course, touch coding is there, but very difficult to manage this, isn't it? So that is one thing. That's also one of the safety features adapted. That means there are stops at either end. So like that, now inside, just inside, before the flow control valves, what you have is the ORMC or SRMC and the you have the link 25, and the link 25 is purely mechanical one. So there are two sprockets, one sprocket for oxygen, another sprocket for nitrous oxide, that is connected by a chain. Both these sprockets are connected by a chain, and there is a spindle is there, and that spindle will operate in such a way that whenever the total flow and oxygen flow ratio, if oxygen ratio is less than the, or 25% or less than the total flow, it engages both the sprockets. Otherwise, it disengages both the sprockets. If you are giving more than 25% of oxygen, the chain will be disengaged from both the sprockets. So that you can keep on rotating only oxygen. And only oxygen you can give 100%. Suppose if they are continuously engaged, so whenever you rotate oxygen, then nitrous oxide also will keep rotating. So in order to prevent that, we have this system of spindle system which disengages and links only whenever the oxygen ratio to the total flow comes down to 25%. Anything that 25% it links, and below that, because its linking is there, whenever you rotate nitrous oxide flow control knob, oxygen also rotates, so that oxygen also will come. So that ratio, minimum ratio of 25% is always made good. And because you know the linking occurs at 25%, that's why it is called as link. And it is purely mechanical, and it gets assisted in case of newer workstations, because you are also reducing the pressures that the flow is coming into the flow meter assembly of these latex Sumada machines, wherein they have got second stage pressure regulators. You are reducing the oxygen pressure to 14 PSI, and you are reducing the nitrous oxide pressures to 26 PSI. So because of that, there is a variation in the pressures also that are coming to these link 25 system. So that it will also help in the working of this link 25 system. So some amount of pneumatic assistance is also there, but majority of the time is purely mechanical. So that is another thing which helps you to prevent any giving a hypoxic mixture to the patient. So the other thing, in case of Draeger machine, what you have is the SRMC, sensitive ratio monitor control, which is now the newer name that is given to ORMC. ORMC is oxygen ratio monitor control. So oxygen ratio monitor control or sensitive ratio monitor control is purely pneumatic. It's purely pneumatic. You have a in between the shaft, the spindle is there, it keeps moving depending on what is the pressure in the oxygen side or what is the pressure in the nitrous oxide side. So when you open oxygen, the spindle, that shaft is there, that moves to the towards the nitrous oxide side, and it opens up the nitrous oxide. When you open oxygen, it can also open nitrous oxide, which you can turn off the nitrous oxide then. Suppose if no oxygen is there, it totally blocks the movement of nitrous oxide. Suppose if you want to open only nitrous oxide, then also the shaft moves towards that side and then it blocks the nitrous oxide. So that's how the sensitive ratio monitor control is always there. It prevents any hypoxic mixture being delivered to the patient. So again, on that day I was telling you, in the exam they may ask you which one is working, whether Link 25 is working or whether it is ORMC is working. So we just now yesterday discussed how you can know in ORMC.
It is open, but in Link 25 it won't work.
Yeah, because in Link 25, as soon as you will not be able to open the
only
nitrous oxide, you cannot, isn't it? So this also will come up. So whereas in case of ORMC, you just cannot open anything if you are trying to open ORMC. So only if you open oxygen, then only you can open the nitrous oxide. So there is a difference between ORMC and Link 25. You can also check from the machine also. You can always know. Okay, now let us go for. So nothing will come. If you try to open nitrous oxide, oxygen also will not flow with, nothing will flow with ORMC. Now because if you open only nitrous oxide, nothing will flow. Whereas in Link 25, they get linked already. If you try to open nitrous oxide, oxygen also flows. So now you know the difference between Link 25 and ORMC. That is again, which one? ORMC, the ratio will be maintained because of there are resistances are there, the back flow will occur. So that's how that is maintained. That's why it is so sensitive. That's why it is called as a sensitive ratio monitor. So the ratio is always maintained. That means you cannot give only nitrous oxide with ORMC. Okay. Now when you are trying to decrease the oxygen, the nitrous oxide also starts decreasing because of that flow also starts decreasing. So the ratio is always maintained. So may not be exactly 25%, but it will be above 25% of oxygen in ORMC. Now coming to the flow control, the flow meter assembly, you know the flow control valves are the fine needle valves. So they can get damaged, fine needle valves. There also as the flows comes out of these needle valves, this is a very narrow opening. And suddenly it comes into a broader flow tubes. So what happens to the pressure?
Decreases.
Again, Bernoulli's principle. As the flows come out through the narrow flow control valves, so when they come out, so naturally the pressure further falls. Like that series of the pressure starts keep falling. By the time the pressure, the gases come out through the common gas outlet, it is just about the atmosphere. It is just about the atmosphere pressure. Throughout there will be a fall of pressures. That's how the pressures which was there about 14 for oxygen and 26 for nitrous oxide keeps falling further. Okay. Now the flow meters. So again these flow meters are there. They'll ask you what is the material with which the flow meters are made of. They are called as hard tubes and Pyrex glass. It is hard Pyrex glass. That is the one which is used for the manufacturing these flow meters, and they are unbreakable, supposed to be. And we have seen many of these flow meters breaking also. It all depends on how beautifully we use them, of course. So if you use roughly, probably they may break. So the flow control, the flow meters are made of Pyrex glass, very hard and unbreakable. And also it is coated inside in order to prevent any static electricity by Croc steel. Croc steel, COCKXTEIN, toxin. So that is a material that they use. They can spray or they can be, they, it is applied from outside. It's a paste is there, applied from outside, and also they spray inside for these flow meters to make the electricity not to stay there. That's what you have to know, because the maximum amount of electricity can get produced in the within the flow meters because of the rotation of the bobbin. Because any rotation, any movement, any friction, these are the three methods by which an electricity can be produced in the machine. When you drag it, so if the wheels, they are not called as wheels, they are called as casters. So that I did not tell you. The wheels are called as casters because the difference between wheels and casters is wheels can move in only one direction. Casters can move in 360 direction. So there is a difference. So they rotate on all 360 directions so that you can move in any direction, smooth movement, because there should not be any friction between the wheels and then the flow. That itself can generate electricity. And you know, in olden days, they used to have even for the flooring anti-static material, so that electricity should go down, should not stay there. If it stays there, many of the time they were using ether. Ether is very heavy when compared to air. It used to settle down, and there could be the fire. So your feet may get caught with the fire that suddenly, isn't it? So you should try to drag it. So that's why the casters, they rotate in 360 degrees, so you can move them. And usually, you know, in majority of the casters, there is an yellow strip is there sometimes, or some yellow marking is there. That yellow marking says that it is anti-static. The material that has been used is an anti-static material. So that is one thing. Sometimes they'll ask you, show that yellow marking there. And many places there will be yellow marking. Even the black bags used to have yellow markings. Before we used to use the black rubber, he said black rubber, the corrugated hose, everywhere yellow markings. So that yellow marking shows that the material that is used has got an anti-static property, so that it will not allow the electricity to stay there. It just moves the electricity away. That's what it is done for this flow meters, the croxtine that is sprayed and also applied from outside. Because of the bobbin now rotating, because of the rotation, it can generate static electricity. So suppose if you don't have croxtine or an anti-static material, the bobbin can get stuck to the wall of the flow meter inside. So if it gets stuck, you don't know what flows, whether the flow, some gases are flowing to the patient or not flowing to the patient. Sometimes it used to occur in the older machine. Some example may ask, okay, suppose if it is stuck, what you do? So you have to touch the flow meter with a moist hand. So you moisten your hand, dip your hand in water and then touch it. So immediately your finger becomes now anti-static. So it will take that electricity from there, which is now static and which has produced the sticking of the bobbin. So immediately the bobbin gets released. So one just practical thing you just remember about this. They may ask you, okay, bobbin is stuck, what to do? So you can say that with a moist finger, you touch that area of the bobbin of the flow meter, immediately it forms. That's what we were doing. It was very common in olden days. Now we have virtual flow meters, where is the flow, no flow meter at all. Where is the bobbin to touch? That is different. But usually you will have this machine. Invariably this machine will be there. A lot of questions will be asked on this machine. So okay, now the flow meters, now they have to be calibrated for each gas. That is one more thing. Each flow meter has to be calibrated for a particular gas. You can't exchange the flow meter. That is another question they'll ask you in the exam. Can I, okay, now this oxygen flow meter is broken in this. I have one more nitrous oxide flow meter from the other machine. Can I replace that nitrous oxide flow meter for this oxygen? So you cannot, because each gas has its own density, and because of that it has got its own property. So you can't, the flow entirely changes. So that's the reason why you can't place a nitrous oxide flow meter for oxygen. So no exchange of flow meters. That's one thing they'll ask you. So you'll have to tell that, because each flow meter is calibrated for that particular gas. It's for air or oxygen or for the nitrous oxide. See, the other thing that you should always know about is All these flow meters are calibrated at 760 millimeters of mercury, that is at the skin level, and 20 degrees centigrade. Usually they are calibrated at that particular temperature and pressure. So now the other thing, the sometimes they'll ask you is, okay, now you are being posted to Ladakh, and can you take this this thing, the machine to Ladakh and then manage? So then you have to say that because they are calibrated at 760 millimeters of mercury, they are not calibrated, they have to be recalibrated. For the Ladakh, the atmospheric pressure is about 400 millimeters. So for 400 millimeters, it has to be recalibrated. So suppose you have no time to recalibrate and you want to use it, then for low flows, there won't be any problem. Why there low flows, there won't be any problem?
Because
you know, these flow meters, they have either a single taper or a double taper. They are always tapered. This one thing you should always remember. They are all the flow meters. Now there are only one cube is there for each of the gas. Whenever you have a single tube for each gas, then each tube is double taper. Whenever you have only no oxygen, one tube is there for oxygen. So this oxygen will have a double taper. Okay, suppose in modern machines you have series of the flow meters. For oxygen you have two flow meters, for nitrous oxide also you have two flow meters. One flow meter is mainly for low flows, another flow meter is for high flows. So when you have two flow meters, they are said to be flow meters in series. That means there is a continuity. There is a continuity, not that here it gives 1 liter, again it starts from 1 liter. No, it starts from the second flow meter is 2 liters, isn't it? So it's a continuity, they are placed in series. So when you have two flow meters for each of the gas, each flow meter is got a single taper. Each flow meter has got a single taper. So the next thing is, I was telling you, every flow meter will have either single taper or double taper. So why they have to be tapered?
So what is tapering?
Tapering means narrowing. Narrowing. Above it is wide, below it is tapered like this. So if you have got a double tapering, so first it comes down and tapers like this, then again straightens a little bit and again straightens. Two taperings. The majority of our modern workstations have got only single tapering because you have got two tubes for each of the gas. So single tapering. So why a tapering is required? Sometimes that will be asked. Nothing to do with the lambda flow or the turbulent flow.
No,
all those are principles. I'm not asking why there has to be a. I told you, people have forgotten already. Another time, I think I told you about this. You see, what happens is, just imagine now, you see, this is 1 liter here. Can you see 1 liter? Now, what should be the 2 liters if there is no tapering? So, it should have been 2 liters should be here. 3 liters somewhere here. Now you have got oxygen 8 liters here. So 8 liters tube has to have a long tubing. Now we have 12 liters of oxygen. So somewhere there is a long tubing. So chances of breaking is very high. And you have to have this one will be somewhere there. And you can't reach. So in order to reduce the length of the flow meters, tapering is done. Not for viscosity or density or turbulence. Because there is this problem is there of tapering, you have all the problems of viscosity and density and all those things. Main reason why the flow meters either single tapered or double tapered. Now if you have only one tube, then you have to have accuracy for low flows also. Unless there is a tapering there, you can't have the accuracy for low flows also. So that's why the double tapering is there in single tube. And you have got two tubes means, for the same gas, then single tapering is there. So, for low flows, you have to have a distance to be more. So that you can know 250 ml, 300 ml, 400 ml you can keep. Whereas, high flows, you don't require any so much of accuracy. Now, it hardly matters if you are giving 6 liters or 7 liters, it hardly matters in high flows. That's why, see, as the tube goes up, it widens. Once it widens, the annular space, it's increasing. The annular space increases. So the annular space is the space between the inner side of the wall and the bobbin. That is the annular space, what you call. So the gases are moving through the annular space. So wider the annular space, more gases can move.
So
And wider the annular space, more turbulence occurs. Or it can be called as an orificial flow, because the length of the bobbin and the annular space, that is C. The annular space, the width of the annular space is much wider than the length of the bobbin. So then it becomes an orifice. You know what is an orifice? Where the depth is less and then the width is more. So that's an orifice. So as the flow goes up, as the gases move up the flow meter, they have an orificial type of flow. Orificial flow is nothing but turbulent flow. You know, whenever turbulent flow is there, it always behaves with the Graham's law. Graham's law. Whereas in laminar flow, it behaves with Hagen-Poiseuille. And we know that the laminar flow, Hagen-Poiseuille's law means the flow is inversely proportional to the viscosity. So, whereas in case of the turbulent flow, flow is inversely proportional to the square root of density. Now, that means flow depends on density in turbulent flow, flow depends on viscosity in laminar flow. So, because when you take this machine to a high altitude area, the viscosity of the gases will not change. But because of the pressure drop, the density of the gases also will come down. So, we know that the flow and density are inversely proportional to each other. So, that means if the density comes down, what happens to the flow?
Flow increases.
Actually, in a Ladakh, I take this and then start using it. I may be using 4 liters, thinking that 4 liters are going. Actually, 6 liters or 7 liters may be going. There is a formula also. They won't ask you this formula and all. Don't worry. How to know exactly at that particular altitude, how to know how much of flow is going. Don't bother. Just say that. If you just say that the density is very important there, and higher flows depends on the Graham's law, and if you say Graham's law is flow is inversely proportional to the square root of density, you will get full marks. Don't bother. Okay. Now you know that those things are there, and these bobbins are made of aluminium. Bobbins are very light, they are made of aluminium, and at the top they have slanted flutes. At the top of the bobbin, you have slanted flutes. So, the molecules of the gas hits these slanted flutes. They make the bobbin to spin. That's how that rotation occurs. And this rotation is very important for us. When it is rotating, we know that the gases are flowing. So, in order to see the rotation even in a dark room, you have a white fluorescent dot. White fluorescent dot. So that will give you an indication that the bobbins are rotating and the gases are flowing. Many times you may have to give anesthesia in dark places, especially the radiology unit. So in that place also, when the darkness is there, you can see the fluorescent dot so moving because of the bobbin become is spinning. So that's one thing. That is again a safety feature. The fluorescent dot on the bobbin, these are safety features you will have to tell about. And the fluorescent backing, the older machines, this backing is a fluorescent backing on the machine. So, because of that fluorescent backing, again you can easily see the movement of the bobbin. So, these are the things which you have to know about as far as the flow meters are concerned. Then comes the back bar and then